Hey all, this video is on sound in film. We're going to be referencing our media production reading. Specifically, this is chapter 2, and we're looking specifically within the sound part, obviously. This is also based off of my 15 or so years of dealing with challenging audio, okay? Now, before we dive in, I want you guys to first watch this clip, and I want you to pay attention to the audio.
I have gone hiking.
By the way, this is something I created, as you can see, 10 years ago.
Mini bouldering.
So we talked about lighting in a previous video. We have some really beautiful lighting here. We have some nice bokeh in the background. So the shot actually looks pretty nice. But if we listen to that audio.
Drastic, but no, I have not done anything like this. Like wakeboarding. Oh, I've done snowboarding. Not very good.
So it's not the worst audio, but it's not great, right? So what happened here is I was trying to edit the audio so much to make it sound good that it turned out that I made her sound kind of like a robot, like it sounds like it's been through too many filters. And then we also have this sort of background noise. Can you hear like the white noise?
Not very good.
And then it cuts out. Do you hear that? So when she's not talking, that white noise cuts out and then comes back and cuts out. And so it's connected to the dialogue, right? I've over-edited the dialogue. What is worse, bad audio or bad video? Now, video is obviously fundamental in film, right? We need video possibly more than we need audio. But viewers often are more willing to be okay with bad video than bad audio, because bad audio hurts our ears. We need to be very conscious of our audio. Your audio is just as important as lighting and just as important as video, okay? But oftentimes, viewers are less forgiving of bad audio than they are of bad video. Because we need to start considering what things should make sound and what things should not make sound. And so we're going to watch just a little bit of this clip right here, and I want you guys to pay attention to everything that makes sound and everything that doesn't make sound. Because again, remember that everything makes at least some sound. And so what are they going to show and what are they not going to show? And this is something that you need to start to consider. And you're also going to want to think about why certain things make sound and why not. All right, so we have doors, we have noises, we have toilet. It's a classic horror movie, if you guys didn't know. Psycho. Remember that Brandon Brock taught us that your camera is essentially where the audience is. So wherever we put the camera, that's where we want the audience to see the information from. Well, the same is true with audio. Wherever the audience is, we should hear audio from that perspective, as if we're standing there, kind of. Okay. Now, sometimes you can break these rules, but this is sort of the basic standard approach. So now we're actually in the shower here. Okay. I want you to pay attention to what's happening back here. All right, so we see the door open. Serial killer is walking closer. All right, so if you want to watch the rest of that, it's a great clip. Do it. But you notice that at the start, everything's quite quiet and we have a lot of different noises happening, right? When we're in the shower, we have this obstruction of noise happening in the shower, and they're trying to put us in the situation, whereas if we are in the shower there, right, just with that character, and so we also can't hear the door opening. The little tricky thing that he does here with video, though, is he shows us it happening, right? Which they'll sometimes show the audience something happening that the subject or the character doesn't see. All right, so this is a good introduction to just start thinking about what things should make sound and what things should not make sound. In our readings, we have this idea of mic on, mic off, fade on, and fade off. So essentially what this means is that if our angle is here and the character is 30 feet away, we should not be able to hear them as if they're standing right next to us, because then they would be on mic. All right, so if they are close to the microphone, it's on mic. If they are far away, it's off mic. Fading on is them walking toward the mic or getting closer to the mic. Fading off, getting further away from the mic. All right, so let's look at this clip from Marriage Story. It's going to help us understand this on mic, off mic thing. And again, just pay attention to how the sound sounds in comparison to where the camera is.
Even though it doesn't make sense anymore.
So we're on mic, right? So here we can actually hear Adam Driver's voice in the background, okay, if we listen closely. But we can't hear it very well, right? And here we can kind of hear him a little bit. Right there, so that oh hey, right? So she has to shout a little bit louder because she's a little further from the camera. Okay, so this is, again, some basic concepts, but we need to remember that the audience hears us from that perspective. So here we have behind obstructions. An example of that would be the shower scene, right? So we have that obstruction of the shower, or if the person is around the corner, or if the person is wearing a mask, right? We have an obstruction there. All right, so let's move on to sound effects. So using sound to establish a setting, like a busy restaurant, right? All the clicking and the people talking, the hum of talk, a blowing train whistle that tells us that we're at a train station. Let's watch how beautifully, in this first minute, Christopher Nolan introduces us to this scene with sound. We first start with some music, okay? Again, we'll focus on sound effects here, but some sound effects in the background there. Christopher Nolan really likes unsettling, kind of intense music here. But notice here, we lose the music. Listen to all the sound effects. So he's really good at using sound and music to help establish a scene. So the next one that we can do is we can use sound to direct our audience's attention or emotion in some way. And so this gives distinct emphasis towards some kind of orientation in the scene, towards some kind of sound. So you might have like a judge banging on the gavel, right? Order, order. This is a great example of directing audience attention with sound. Okay, right here. This is where it's at. So we had a ton of noise, a lot of sound, maybe some music, But oftentimes when we really want to direct emphasis towards certain sound effects, sometimes the music will die down, right? And now we're just hearing the little splatter of the different drops, right? And now we can hear all of these little tiny cracks, right? And it's directing our emotion and our attention toward this glass, right? Oh God, this glass is gonna break. So great example there. Establishing a time is pretty simple. This is another thing you can do with sound effects, like a rooster crowing, echoed footsteps in a deserted city because it's 5 a.m., right? This one is, again, a very obvious example. Cinderella, you know, her magic goes away at midnight, and we know that from the start of the film. And so when midnight hits...
Oh, my goodness.
What's the matter?
It's midnight.
Yes, so it is, but why...
Goodbye.
No, wait.
And so at midnight, she has to run away, right, before all the magic disappears. And we have that sound. It's, again, somewhat obvious, but it's helpful. The next thing we can do is we can use sound effects to establish a certain mood. The sound here is going to help us establish his feelings, okay? They're going to help inform his feelings here. All right, so let's watch that again. So it's this disoriented feeling, right? You guys can kind of maybe pick it up based off of the sound. He can't quite hear. He doesn't know what's going on. It feels slow motion, right? And then that bullet, that whizzing bullet, is quite loud and sort of brings him back a little bit. This can also be done if you're like at a party. You know, let's say your character is at a party and they're having a good time. Well, then you're going to showcase lots of loud noise and having fun, right? Having a good time. But if they're not having a good time, let's say they're anxious at this party, well, then there's a lot of interesting things you could do with the audio. And so you can help establish mood in your character through sound as well, signifying entrances and exits in sound effects. We're not going to look at an example of this one because it's pretty obvious, but like footsteps fading away as they walk off camera. Or let's say we have two people eating dinner in a cafe and it's the end of the movie and they're talking. Well, we might like slowly just walk back, right? And as we walk back, we slowly can't hear their conversation anymore. The next sound effect we're going to focus on is sound effects that serve as transitions. So we're going to watch Fight Club here. Now, this one has a narration as well as transition. So let's not focus too much on the narration, although it's a beautiful narration. Let's instead focus on the sound effects that help tie each clip together, because there's a whole bunch of clips that happen in this, and he's moving from location to location to location, and they're using the sound effects in the background to help tie them together.
You wake up at SeaTac. SFO, LAX. You wake up at O'Hare, Dallas.
Wait till
Fort
he gets
Worth,
to the airport here.
BWI, Pacific,
got some
Mountain,
weird music.
Central. Lose an hour, gain an hour.
Check in for that flight doesn't begin for another 2 hours, sir.
This is your life, and it's ending 1 minute at a time.
We have the, you know, the speaker overhead, them talking, right? I paused right at the transition. Let's go back. Let's listen to that.
You wake up at Air Harbor International. If you wake up at a different time, in a different place, could you wake up as a different person? Everywhere I travel.
You see that transition? We had the same overhead noise from here.
Everywhere I travel.
This really helps connect scenes together a lot easier. It's going to be one of the things that helps your audience forget that they're watching a film. I know I said don't focus on the narration, but let's look at the narration here for the next 20 seconds. Just pay attention to how beautiful the words are.
Everywhere I travel, tiny life, single serving sugar, single serving cream, single pat of butter, the microwave cordon bleu hobby kit, shampoo conditioner combos, sample packaged mouthwash, tiny bars of soap. The people I meet on each flight, they're single serving friends.
All right. Yeah. I just really love that concept of single serving. And then he brings it, this nice, interesting metaphor of single serving items into friends. And this is one thing we do want to consider if we're doing narration, is really making your narration sound really good. Okay. We'll talk about that a little bit later. So the next one I want to talk about, the final one, in fact, is creating non-realistic effects. You can use non-realistic effects for creativity, to create a certain style. It's oftentimes used to convey a feeling in the audience, not in the character. So when we were talking about establishing mood, we were talking about the feeling that that the characters feel. Here, we might be talking a little bit more about the feelings that we want to create in the audience, right? When we have like that really low humming noise, brrr, it might make us feel anxious or upset, right? Oftentimes horror movies will make a lot of weird noises to make us feel something. Edgar Wright uses non-realistic effects really creatively. Basically, he exaggerates all of his effects to the extreme for creative and stylistic reasons, and also to get the audience to feel something. Let's watch the 30 seconds here.
Don't be afraid of your freedom!
If you want intense, dynamic cuts, you need to make sure there are actions that have a strong oral component. A Wright trademark are the quick montage of shots that are usually built around these types of actions. Even if spreading jam or pulling pints aren't exactly dramatic,
John, yes, please, mate.
The sound design exaggerates them for a visceral feeling. Or he'll subvert this method for comic effect. And watch how it smoothly transitions to the beginning of the next scene, where it sounds like we're submerged in the water from the previous shot.
I don't believe this.
All right, yeah, so he actually is doing a few different things here. So remember the idea of sound effects serving as transitions? Well, he does a great job with that here. But he's also using non-realistic effects to serve as transitions as well. But he's using this as his own style, but also to be absurd, right? Because oftentimes Edgar Wright is making comedy films. Regarding music, I'm not going to get too much into detail with music, but what I will say is most of us understand the type of music that makes us feel certain ways, happy or sad, excited, horror. And so I would just say to use the appropriate music for your situation, or if music is needed, or if silence is needed. I would say you want to focus on the appropriate tone for your music, and based off of how you want us to feel or how you want us to know that the character feels, and it shouldn't overpower the dialogue or be too loud. So those are the main points of sound effects. I'm now going to give you guys just a couple of tips on how to make your sound better. I'm going to share this clip with you guys. We're not going to watch the whole thing, but I want you to start at 7:30 here. Essentially, this is a guide on how to equalize your dialogue, okay? Specifically, to make it sound more realistic and sound better. Now, this guy right here is a professional sound editor. Listen to how great his audio is, by the way.
And I do a limiting. So this is my secret... well, I guess not so secret anymore, but it is my EQ.
Isn't that beautiful? Sounds great, right? Like a podcast. He does edit podcasts, okay? So I'd recommend watching this. Essentially, this is the EQ, right? Equalizer. And so we have the low tones and the high tones. And he'll just tell you guys the best way to do this if you want to try it out. It does depend on each individual clip. But here he's cutting out the all the unnecessary deeper noises. So if you have like a, you know, like if my water cooler there is humming, that might make that deep noise. And so cutting that out can help. The other thing he does is if you notice, so what I want you to do right now is I want you to put your hand on your chest here. And I want you to just talk, say something, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can feel, as I'm talking right now, I can feel vibrations happening inside of me, right? So when we're speaking, when we're talking, it's not just the stuff coming out of our mouth, but our body vibrates, okay? And that actually creates this sort of hollow, but also deep. It's a mixture of hollow and also deepness. And so what he's doing here is he's just trying to mimic that to create this more realistic sound as if they were really there physically in person. Okay, so check that out. How to make your audio sound good. So I'm going to give you guys some tips. First, you want your audio to be good enough, of course, so that we don't really think about it as a viewer. Okay, so what you can do is, one, you can limit outside noises. So no one should be talking while you're recording, right? Noises aren't overpowering the dialogue. Random noises are subdued or turned off, like refrigerator, air conditioner, humming lights, a fan in the background, hitting the microphone. I'm sure you guys have probably heard it. Or right? That right there kind of hurts. I'll turn that down so it doesn't annoy you. Subjects in the scene, if they're hitting the desk, or if they're moving their hands, or if their clothes are rubbing, tapping things. You really want to pay attention to all of these sounds and limit them as much as you can. If you record something, you should listen to it automatically. If your cameraman has the ability to monitor the audio, then that's great. It's not required. I'm currently monitoring my audio as I speak here, so I can hear that this is too far away, right? And so I can kind of tell how loud I am here. These are actual monitor headphones, and so they're built to edit audio, but any headphones will help. So one other thing you want to do is limit echo. One thing you can do is you can clap in a loud room, and you can hear if there is echo. It just helps us kind of hear, okay, yeah, it's really echoey in here. Let's close the blinds. Maybe we'll hang a blanket on the wall there, or we'll go somewhere else that's less echoey. That's all under this concept of limiting outside noise and being very conscious of what noise is coming in. Audio should be consistent across your video. You don't want the highest sounds to be way, way, way high and the lowest sounds to be way, way, way low, or else it's going to be uncomfortable and difficult to watch. We're not going to be able to hear some of the things. Some of the things are going to hurt our ears, and we're going to have to play with the volume. Have you ever watched a video where you've had to like turn up the volume and then turn down the volume and then turn up the volume, right? It's annoying. We don't like that. So you want to keep it within acceptable levels, okay? And you can see your own audio levels in your video editor. One thing I would recommend to keep audio consistent is to record audio consistently. So if you're recording a voiceover, you should record it in the same way, at the same time, in the same day. If you're doing it multiple times, I would probably recommend recording your voiceover all at once, but pay attention to where and how you record it, how far away your voice is from the microphone or your phone, whatever you're recording on. And if you have to reshoot that audio, do it in the exact same way so that it doesn't sound different. If it does sound different, you may have to reshoot all of that narration. Regarding voiceovers, they should be practiced. Okay, practice your voiceover a lot before you record it. Try different things. Try different intonations. Try different emotions. Try different feelings when you're practicing. Don't just use your first try or your first idea. Just experiment with it a little bit. Okay, you should be comfortable. As a narrator, you are also a character. The narrator is a character, so that means you're an actor, so you should act. Enunciate fully, okay? We want to make sure we're enunciating all of our words. Unlike me, you should not speak too fast. I speak too fast all the time. Also, listen to it, okay? Make sure you're listening to it and making sure that it sounds good. I'll provide a bunch of links in the description box down below to some of the stuff that we looked at in this video, as well as some of the things we didn't look at. Specifically, I have a lot of examples of narration down below. If you're interested in narration, you can kind of check some of those out. The final thing I'll say is just to be very conscious of the audio and what you want to have sound and what you don't want to have sound, and make sure that things that you don't want to have sound are not showing up, okay? And the things that you do want to have sound, you're actually creating some good sound effects, or you're including that sound as you shoot. Thanks, guys. Hopefully that was helpful. See you next time.